Retro. No.
Hello there. This is James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi, and whenever I'm in this part of the galaxy, I listen to Dennis and Jay on podcast Stardust. Makes flying a little more tolerable. Don't tell Anakin.
This is podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, this is Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to Podcast Stardust, the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. This week, we'll be discussing Claudia Gray's Into the Dark. But before we get to that, Jay, where can everybody find us on social media?
Well, it's pretty easy to do, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
So we are going to be discussing the third book of the High Republic. We've talked about Light of the Jedi. There was A Test of Courage. And now we've got Claudia Gray's Into the Dark. As always, this will be a full spoiler discussion. You may remember Claudia Gray from Lost Stars, Leia, Princess of Alderaan, Master and Apprentice, some of her earlier Star Wars works. And now, of course, she is one of the contributors to the High Republic publishing initiative. And this is her first entry. And like a lot of other stuff, it's a young adult focused novel. So, Jay, this book... Well, normally we start off with a summary, but there's just way too much here to try and condense it down into about three paragraphs like we'd usually do. And so we're just not going to. We'll get into some of the bigger points here. But this is a story that takes place within the story that was set out in Light of the Jedi. So we've had the Great Disaster. This book starts just before that, and then it concludes at about the same place as Light of the Jedi. Are you enjoying how all these books are kind of not telling the same story, but telling about what the Jedi or various Jedi are doing at about the same time as these key events?
I actually do. I think that the whole process is a very smart process, I guess is the best word that I can come up with for it. But I love how they're all intertwined where it's not so disjointed and disconnected between different stories that, you know, there's things happening over here and there's things happening over here, but yet you don't have to know about everything to appreciate each one of those stories either. So I probably didn't explain that really well, but, you know, it's just like this big spider web, I guess, of stories, and they're all interconnected, and but yet they can also exist on their own. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. It does. And basically the point being is that if you want the full story, if you want all the details, then read everything. But if you don't, then you don't have to. You could read this one and fully appreciate everything that's going on. You wouldn't get all the details of the Great Disaster, the hyperspace disaster that came up in Light of the Jedi. But none of that is necessary to understand the key plot points that happen in this book. It really only answers why there was a problem with hyperspace in the first place in this book. So, in a nutshell, the book starts. Reath Silas, who's a Padawan, and some other Jedi are getting ready to catch a ride on a ship and go to Starlight Beacon. They get into hyperspace, and that's when the hyperspace disaster occurs. They're forced to exit hyperspace. They then follow a beacon to a space station where they find another ships that are in trouble of getting destroyed by a solar flare. All these ships end up on the space station. There is a dark presence there. They take some dark side idols off the station that they think are creating a darkness in the Force, only to find out that they were holding back the Drengear. In the meantime, there is also a subplot with an isle that comes up, and the whole thing concludes with them going back to kind of confront the Drengear, and we'll talk about more than a second there at the end, and some of the relationships between the characters change over. That's a very, very, very high level discussion of this book. And we'll get into a lot more of the details. We can't cover possibly everything in 45 minutes to an hour. Right. It's just a lot of stuff going on here. It's not as sweeping in scale as Light of the Jedi, because it really does focus on a much smaller core group of characters, and it gives them all more attention, which I liked quite a bit. I don't get me wrong. Light of the Jedi, I think, is still my favorite book in the High Republic, but it didn't spend as much time with any one character as this book does with its core characters.
And, you know, as you're talking about all that too, it just hits me actually how much scope there really is in this book and how much there really is actually going on. And what I really appreciate about the book as well is, aside from the story, which I actually really enjoyed quite a bit, and we'll get into that here in just a little while, but I really liked how the ideals of the Jedi were addressed at this point in time that we're dealing with the era of Jedi that we're seeing right now. And of course, this is supposed to be where the Jedi are at their prime, but yet there's still some Jedi that are not necessarily, I don't want to say buying into the ideals of the Jedi, but they're questioning it. But yet there's also a great representation, I think, of the way that masters and apprentices get along and what their relationships are like and how training in general is approached by masters and Padawans. And it's a real kind of coming of age sort of a book too. As you mentioned, obviously it's a young adult novel that Claudia Gray has brought us. And I think that young people could really relate to a lot of the themes that are going on in this book too. So the story aside, which is, like I said, just a great story, I really appreciated those other things going on here too.
Right. And while there are several characters that are central to the story, the young adult angle, I think, here is primarily through the two point of view characters, the two main point of view characters. You got Reath Silas, who is a Jedi Padawan, and then you got Affie Hollow, who is the co-pilot of the vessel, which is literally a ship called the vessel, because it's Captain Leoch Jassy. Just, it's like, you know, that's the point of this thing. It's the vessel. It gets people from where place to place. It's the inside that matters. He's kind of mystical that way. But Reath is, I guess, if I was going to describe him, he is the Padawan to Jedi Master Jorah Mali, who we met in Light of the Jedi. She is an older Togruta Jedi Master. Reath is one of her later Padawans. We know she's had at least two. I can't remember if they said she had any others. Of course, we know she dies in the events of Light of the Jedi, and that comes up later in this book. She gets separated from Reath, and he is much more interested in being an archivist and working in the Jedi Temple on Coruscant. He does not crave adventure. He's much more of an academic. He doesn't have as much talent as a lot of others in the Force, but he works harder than anybody else to excel. And his entire world gets rocked after he and Jorah stop some pirates on Coruscant, and she informs him that they're going to Starlight Beacon, which is out there on the frontier. It is the absolute last thing he wants, because he wants to stay on Coruscant. What did you think about Reath overall?
I really liked him as a character, and I think that's really refreshing that they're approaching a character that isn't all about the adventure, and they're not all about the lightsaber training and the battling and that type of thing, and they're able to show these other sides of what really is valued in the Jedi Order, and that Reath is one of those kind of Jedi that Padawans that really does fit well into that niche of, as you said, the academic, the researcher, and that type of thing. But yet when he's called upon to do something adventurous, even if it's not in his wheelhouse or his comfort zone, that he is willing to take up that mantle. And I thought he was very brave. He was very empathetic. He was very compassionate towards basically everyone. He had a very inquisitive mind, maybe a little too trusting at times of some people, which is understandable because, you know, I think anybody would have probably fallen into the same trap that we'll talk about here in just a little bit. But overall, I really enjoyed him as a focus of a young character in this novel. But what did you think?
No, I liked him as well for many of the same reasons. And he's very thoughtful. He's very introspective, and he knows his place in the galaxy. And then I want to get into some of the other characters here and how they relate. And of course, as I was saying, the other kind of point of view character we get here is Affie Hollow, another young woman. And one of the reasons why I identify them as the point of view characters is because it is a young adult novel. They're typically focusing on the younger protagonists. This one does something interesting in that we have some older Jedi, which we'll get to in a second, but then we go back to a scene when they were Padawans and younger as well. And we're seeing how their earlier life impacted their older lives. But so, you know, we got Afi Hollow. She was orphaned when her parents were killed during a transport run working for the Buying Guild. And then she was essentially adopted by the head of the guild, who a person named Scover. And she's kind of doing rotation across ships to learn the way to, you know, the system, the idea that she'll take a bigger role in the guild at some point. But she's really come to love working on the vessel with Leox Giassi. And, you know, how else would you describe Afi?
I think you did a great job of describing her. She's one that she's always wanted to know what happened to her parents. And, you know, of course, here we go again with another Star Wars orphan kind of a thing. But I do think that she is very genuine in what she wants, in terms of she wants to be accepted, but yet she also wants, because she's always looking at Scover from that point of view that she's trying to measure up, but yet she's also very much about doing the right thing. And she's got this code of ethics about her that maybe that was instilled in her by her parents, but that she's all about doing that right thing. And sometimes even to a fault. But I don't know. I really did like her character. I think that's probably the best way I can describe it.
Right. And so they interact because, again, the vessel, which, again, Captain Leox Giassi, Afi, and then we've got perhaps one of the oddest characters in this book, Geode, which is this sentient rock thing that is the navigator on the vessel. Okay, let's take just a second to talk about Geode. Because he's kind of the ongoing joke throughout this book, in that every time we see him, he's standing stock still, and he looks like just like a big boulder there wherever he is. But then Leox Giassi and Afi constantly make comments like, you know, oh, he's out at the clubs, we know he's a wild man, but sometimes he's got to slow down. And and of course, which is just the comedy of it all, because we don't know how he gets from place to place and does things he does, because as far as we know, he has no limbs, but he has this personality even though he himself never actually exhibits one.
Right. And it's kind of crazy in a way, because I wonder if Claudia Gray had a pet rock as a kid. Do you remember those pet rocks when maybe you're too young to
remember? No, I remember what they were. I never had one, but I do remember the pet rocks.
Oh, my goodness. But yeah, because of course, you know, at first we've got Geode kind of just there in the ship. And I absolutely love the way that they talk about him, because like you said, they almost talk about him in third person, sort of almost like, is he really there? Did he just move? Did he do this? Did he do that? But yet, you know, they're talking about him as being this like crazy, you know, wild and crazy guy kind of a thing. And I don't know, I guess that's probably why I liked his character so much, just because it was so refreshing. And it was so different, and it was just kind of quirky enough to where it wasn't cheesy, but it was believable. And you really felt a lot for this rock, this geode. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't really know how else to say it, but
speaks word cool. In this entire book.
No.
And one of the things that Leox says that kind of gets around that is that if you actually have a mouth, then you aren't actually able to speak like him, and you can't say his real name, so they just call him Geode. But yeah, so there's Geode. I know that kind of caught a lot of people by surprise when some who had not actually read this book saw him in the character video for Leox, and right. There's this rock that's a navigator, and everyone got crazy. I don't know. I think you really have to give this book a chance and get to know who Geode is supposed to be, and it's makes it, you can, so that you can appreciate it. But it is a bit of a gimmick, I'll say that, but it's fun and it's enjoyable. So again, there's a lot of plot lines here. They have chartered the vessel under Captain Leox Giassi and Afi Hollow to get them to Starlight Beacon when their primary transport gets laid up somewhere and they can't use it. They no sooner get to hyperspace, and then they have to deal with the events of Light of the Jedi, as we said already, that have corrupted hyperspace. There's debris there. It's not safe to travel. So they come out of hyperspace, but some pre-programmed coordinates take them to the space station. Let's talk about the space station just a little bit, Jay. This station, we come to find out over the course of the novel, was built by the Amaxine warriors. And furthermore, it's not the first time Star Wars fans may have seen the station. It was featured in The Rise of Kylo Ren, the comic book that was written by Charles Soule. And it's where Snoke had kind of set up himself prior to becoming the head guy in the First Order, or maybe he already was, but at least while he was trying to recruit Ben Solo, that was where he was working from. It was not specifically addressed as such in this book. And it was not until we got the character video for the Dringir for the High Republic that they kind of showed us explicitly that that's what the case was. And then Charles Soule and some others have talked about it on Twitter. But I really love that we have that connection between the High Republic and the Rise of Kylo Ren.
Oh, I do too. And I've been eye popping left and right with some of these things because, and I had even screenshotted them because you were further in the book than I was at that point. And so I had seen this in, as you mentioned, the video for the Dringir, the character video. And then as soon as I saw it, that's when my mind went back to when we had reviewed all the Rise of Kylo Ren novels and where that station was with Snoke, where Kylo Ren had actually met up with Snoke. And like I said, that was kind of an eye-popping, like, huh? Sort of a moment for me. And when you mentioned the Amaxine Warriors, for me, my mind immediately went to the Bloodlines novel. And so, I know I had texted you and said, oh, the Amaxines, that was the one that Rin Riv and Dai was all about, and in the napkin bombing and everything else. And so I do really appreciate that as well, is that they're doing such an impressive job of pulling all of these puzzle pieces together. And I just think it's pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah. And so the Amaxine warriors were this ancient race that were... they were just warriors, and they were interested in conquest and fighting. And then when the High Republic came about, they removed themselves from the galaxy because there was no purchase to be had there. They couldn't resist the Republic, so they went someplace else. We don't know where exactly to fight. And then, as you said, they were brought up again during the Bloodline novel, just prior to the First Order coming about. Not the same Amaxine warriors, but they were a source of inspiration for others.
Right.
But they built the station, and this station is overrun by plant life. It's described as a giant arboretum of sorts. And there is this shadow that's kind of being projected that the Jedi character. So we've got Reath Silas. We've got Dez Ryden, who is Jorah Mahley's former apprentice and kind of acts in a big brother role to Reath. They aren't as close as some other Padawans that had the same master may have been. Mm-hmm. Then we've also got Orla Jirini, who is a Jedi Wayseeker, and she is an Umbaran, so she's got that white skin, she wears white robes, and she carries a hinged double-bladed white lightsaber. And then there's Master Komak Vitus, who is a friend of Orla Jirini's from long ago. He is not an archivist in the way that Reath Silas is, but he is interested in collecting folklore and the likes from the various planets he visits. And Orla teases him that he doesn't like go to the same planets twice. He's interested in going from place to place and learning new things. And there's an interesting conversation between Reath and Komak about how it is that he learns all this folklore, that you can't just go someplace and ask it. The best folklore comes from what people just choose to reveal eventually when you've been around and doing other things. But when they get to the station, they determine that there's a shadow there. And I'm going to cut to the chase because we don't have time to be circumspect about it. But it turns out that they find some idols there on the station that they determine were left by the Sith. And their immediate thought is that the shadow, this dark presence they're feeling, is coming from these idols. But what we later find out is that the Sith had left them there to suppress a dark presence, which was actually the Dringir, who we've encountered kind of circumstantially in other places. They've come up in the High Republic comic. They were in the Galaxy's Edge edition of Dark Legends. We've had a character video about them. but they are this sentient plant-like species that are pretty tough. But these idols essentially put them into a stasis here on the station, and they were intended to keep the Dringar from expanding into this area of space, because this the station was their portal into this area of the galaxy.
Yes. And I have to say, I am pretty captivated by the idea of where this species came from and how the Sith encountered them in the first place, and just how they ended up being trapped there, and what the process was behind that, which hopefully we're going to get that in one of the other High Republic books. And if not, I hope that we get that in some sort of a supporting media, because this has really piqued my interest, quite honestly.
Right. And so the Jedi remove these idols, and they're going to take them back to Coruscant, to the Jedi Temple, and then attempt to dissipate the dark side presence that's in the idols into the Vergence that's there underneath the temple, which is a really cool idea. I like mm-hmm. that a lot. But of course, when they get the idols there, nothing happens. And then it dawns on them that the dark side presence was not in the idols itself. It was a suppression for the idols. And by having removed the idols from that station, they remove the suppressor, and that's when the Dringar that are there on the station activate. They come out of stasis, mm-hmm. and it creates a big problem.
Whoops.
Yeah. Okay. So there's part of the plot line. You know, the Nile figure into this but they're much more a smaller portion of the story.
They are.
And I don't want to completely ignore them, but I kind of want to talk about some of the bigger things. I want to talk about Orla just a bit. As we mentioned she's this Jedi Wayseeker. So she has this double-bladed hinged lightsaber that's got white blades. And Jay, I'm a little confused by that, because the way one creates white lightsabers is by healing kyber crystals that have been corrupted by the Sith, by them pouring their heat into them. But the Sith have been gone for centuries at this point. So how did this happen?
I have been thinking a lot about this as well, Dennis, and my only thought, and I could be completely off base here, is because, as we know, kyber crystals oftentimes are connected to the Force user that they call out to. So the only thing that I could think of was either perhaps the kyber crystals that she has were from another Jedi or from another Force user, and so she altered them in a way that they became neutral, or she found them that way somehow, and that is her personality, her Force presence, that is completely neutral as a Wayseeker, that type of kyber crystal would have called out to her. So that's about my only thought, but what are you thinking?
Yeah, I really don't know, because I mean, the whole concept of the white lightsaber crystal, it was developed for Ahsoka, mm-hmm. and this was something that was in scripts that E.K. Johnston then adapted for the Ahsoka novel. And so, again, I got to believe this was a Dave Filoni idea about how one gets a white lightsaber crystal. And then, you know, Charles Soule showed Darth Vader bleeding a crystal in his Darth Vader series when Vader went out and defeated a Jedi that had taken the Barash vow. And of course that crystal never got peeled by a Jedi, but regardless, it just, there's been lore built up around this. And so, you know, perhaps there is something, perhaps when she was looking for her crystals, she was called to some that were ancient kyber crystals that a Sith had used. And then she took it upon herself to heal them. And that helped get her into knighthood. But I mean, she had these white lightsaber crystals when she was a Padawan. I think part of this is because Claudia Gray had this white motif going on for Orla Trenny, you know, the white robes, the white skin, and everything else. And so white lightsaber blades went with that. And this is something that's left out there to intrigue readers. And I'd be interested to see what they're thinking if they've thought about a backstory. But again, all you and I can do is speculate. But I hope it's just something that wasn't overlooked, is what it comes down to. And I trust that they'll have figured out a good story for that.
Agreed.
So the other thing about Orla and Master Komak is that they were friends, they were Padawans, and there is a mission from their past that has influenced them quite a great deal. And they were sent with their Jedi Masters to resolve a kidnapping of the one of, okay, I'm going to try and get this I'm trying to say this so it's not confusing. There's two planets. There is Arona and Irem. They're in the same system. They're almost locked in their orbit together around their sun. And there's a moon in between them. The two planets and their inhabitants have been hostile towards each other for so long that no one can remember why. They just don't talk to each other. They don't negotiate. They're just hostile. But then there is a Lasat who kidnaps the monarch of Arona, whose name is Cassel, and he's a Pantoran, and then kidnaps Queen Thandanka of Irem, which is the wrong queen because she's the consort of the real queen, Dima. And the idea is to try and extort some ransom out of the Republic, but then to ultimately stage a failure so that the people in this area realize that the Jedi and the Republic can do nothing for them, and that the Hutts and the other elements in this area of the galaxy are something to be feared, and they'll turn on themselves and they'll start selling off their own people as slaves to basically buy off the Hutts. But then, so the Jedi go to intervene with this, and over the course of this mission, Komax Master is killed, which is a really interesting character. He's essentially a giant snake, even more so than Opo Rancisis, as he has no arms. I'm not sure how he carries a lightsaber, but that's right. A special power time. And then ultimately, Cassel dies protecting Thandika, which leads to a reconciliation between the two worlds. And so when Starlight Beacon is built in their area of space, Thandika shows up and pays tribute to Cassel. And it's just kind of a monument and a tribute to the work of the Jedi and the ability to kind of overcome these difficulties in the area.
You did a very superb job of explaining all of that, much, much better than I could have ever done. very concise. And yes, and I was a little confused in some ways as to what the purpose was of that kind of side story as they were flashing back to, you know, back and forth between those different kinds of things. But of course, you know, the payoff comes a little bit later. And with Thandeka showing up, as you said, at the Starlight Beacon ceremony, and just kind of showing what roundabout way the Jedi actually do have that far-reaching kind of help, I guess you could say, in the galaxy, even though sometimes things don't go the way that they plan them. But I was a little confused by that whole storyline. Like, I kept thinking to myself, what does this have to do with the story? What does this have to do with the book, really? So I was a little taken out of the main story quite often by trying to reorganize my brain again around this one. So how did you feel about that story being intertwined?
Well, I'm a little bit with you, because we kept getting an allusion to the fact that something that happened in Komak and Orla's past has caused some sort of a dissatisfaction with the way that they see the Jedi Order. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's different for each one of them. Komak, he's got a difference of opinion when it comes to the Jedi Order about attachment. And the best way he can phrase it is that a master and apprentice spend years together. The master teaching the apprentice, and then this brotherly, sometimes parental child bond forms between the two of them. Then when suddenly one of them dies, the Jedi attitude is, oh, you can't have attachments. He's one with the Force. Rejoice that he's joined the Force. You can't grieve. You can't be angry. You're not supposed to mourn, these type of thing. And he's just kind of like, well, if I can't be more, I can't mourn about this. You know, what exactly are we doing? I mean, who are we supposed to be? We're not being human. How can we possibly empathize with anybody else if we can't acknowledge our own emotions? Meanwhile, you've got Orla, who she does not disagree with the teachings of the Jedi. She does not believe in the attachment, and, you know, or she preaches no attachments and things like that. But it's the direction of the Jedi. She's seen them kind of ignoring the will of the Force and advising other things be done at the point. So again, there's some disillusionment between these two. Not between these two. There's some dilution with these two and the Jedi Order, but for different reasons. And so they kind of use this backstory to explain how they got there, why Orla became a Wayseeker, and why Komak has got some dissatisfaction, hasn't taken a Padawan. But again, we just kind of get hints about that. And it's not, and they break up that backstory into chunks and spread it out throughout the entire novel. So it's a little hard to grasp the whole thing until you get to the end of it.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and this is what I was getting at in the beginning of our discussion when I said that I did appreciate the attention that the questioning of the ideals of the Jedi actually got. And between the two of them, and as you said, they had a slightly different way of looking at that questioning. So for me, this goes all the way back to the idea of listening to the whispers. You know, when there's something not right in your personal life, or if there's something not right with you, your health, you got to listen to the whispers. And I think in this way, these two Jedi and their concerns about the way that things were being handled, these are whispers. And then, of course, what we get centuries later is the shouts. And that's what eventually, as Luke called it, the hubris that ended up ending the Jedi Order.
Sure. I will be frank. I like these two characters. I like a lot of things they did throughout the two books, but I did not enjoy this aspect of the character, that they had these doubts about the Jedi Order. And it's not that no one could. It's just that this series was billed as being the golden age of the Jedi and the Jedi Knights of the Round Table, right? And here we have two characters that are exhibiting doubts about the direction of the Jedi and the teachings of the Jedi, which really is much more reminiscent of the Jedi of the prequel trilogy. And I kind of feel like we've explored that story. And maybe I'm a little bit more interested in their heroics and these Jedi going out and doing the glorious things. Does that make sense, what I'm talking about here?
No, I can totally appreciate that. So the themes themselves, you were hoping would be pushed aside to favor that golden age more than the themes that we've kind of already seen, which I can totally understand that. Mm-hmm, sure.
I want to see the gold instead.
Right,
and so,
right.
But I mean, fortunately, though, their disillusionment, while it comes up from time to time, it doesn't overpower the novel. For that, I was thankful. It's something, you know, Orla eventually by the end of this book acquires her own ship because she's going out there to find her way and go where the Force takes her. She's going to listen to the Force and be where she needs to be. And then hopefully she'll come to an understanding, which leads her back to the Jedi Order. Komak, he's still struggling with all of this, but at the end of the novel, once the Dringar have been defeated, the Nile have been driven off of the Amaxing station, he's kind of contemplating things in the temple. And then Reath shows up, who has been presented with a choice by the Jedi Order, which is, you know, you've lost your master and you need some time to adjust to that, but we're giving you a choice. You can either, you need to let us know what either you'd like to have a master that will be doing work out on the frontier, or if you'd like to go the more traditional route with a master that's working here on Coruscant or one of the core worlds, which is, again, a more traditional setting. You can get off on the traditional foot with a new master, which would work best for you. And he doesn't answer the masters right away, but he ultimately asks Master Komak to be his new Jedi master. And Komak agrees because he realizes that he's never taken a Padawan and he's working through this attachment issue. And the best way he can do that is by taking a Padawan for the first time. So I did like that part of it. But one of the reasons that Reath even approaches Komak is because before she died, when Reath was struggling with this idea that he was going to have to leave Coruscant and go to Starlight Beacon, Master Orla had given him this riddle, which is, why can no Jedi cross the Kyber Arch alone? So I really like this, Jay, and I kind of wish we'd seen the Kyber Arch elsewhere. But the So in the temple, there is a bit of a ravine that's been made, and then there is an arch that's been built across it that is made out of Kyber crystals that have come out of the lightsabers of fallen Jedi. And it's thicker in space and it's more narrow at the apex of the arch. In an act of meditation, Jedi will cross over it all the time. So this confuses Reath because he's like, well, I see Jedi cross the arch by themselves all the time. And even asks Dez about this, about, and Dez is confounded by the riddle too. He's like, I don't know. I see, you know, I've done it. I've gone over the arch. So I don't know what Master Orla is talking about. But finally, by the end of the book, Reath gets it. He understands what the resolution to the riddle is. Did you understand the resolution? Did you pick up on it before he did? Or how did this sit with you?
Well, you know, I knew that there was going to be some payoff at the end in terms of trying to explain what this riddle actually meant. And I guess the resolution that he figured out was that, you know, with the idea of the Jedi helping each other throughout the ages, and it's not in a literal sense, you know, I guess it was a good resolution, and I bought into it, and yeah. I was okay with it. So how did you feel?
Well, I had spent a lot of time thinking about it because it came up like 3 or 4 times over the course of the novel. I mean, it was one of the first things that was said in the book, you know, back there in the prologue. But then again, it's this, why can't a Jedi cross the arch? As an adult compared to Reath, I think, you know, the solution was a little bit more obvious to me, which is that who really gets anywhere in life by themselves? You have to have a mentor or a teacher that's shown you the road, or you've had customers that have helped give you their business if you're running, you know, and that's made your business successful, or you've had a coworker that has stayed and worked long hours. In pretty much every case, your success may be the result of your own hard work, but there's been other people that have played a role in that. And in this case, the arch is even more a concrete symbol of things because it's made from the crystals of fallen Jedi. So it's the people that have come in the order before you. If they hadn't fallen, there'd be no arch to begin with. And then it's been the other Jedi in the order that have assembled the arch. And so it is a collective that makes the Jedi successful. And then realizes that, you know, at the beginning of this entire story, he was thinking about himself, not about quote unquote us, the Jedi Order. And he needs to stop doing that, which is one of the reasons why he wants to go with Master Komak and explore the frontier. And he knows Komak's going to go to Starlight Beacon. Mm-hmm. And so I was afraid this is one of those things that wasn't going to have a satisfactory payoff, but I like the way it worked out there at the end.
I did too. And like you said, it is a young adult novel. And so the themes are kind of, I don't want to say preaching to people of that general age group, because I think we can all stand to learn a lesson from a lot of these integrated kinds of things that are going on in these. But yeah, overall, I liked how it was tied from the very beginning of the novel, and you got the resolution at the end, and it kind of tied a nice little bow on things.
Right. So we've talked about how the Jedi have dealt with the Sith artifacts. You know, they brought them back to the station. They kind of got the Maxine back in stasis. There was a little bit of a subplot that we don't have a lot of time to go into, but it looked like Dez Ryden had been killed by just a random malfunction on the station when he, in fact, had been transported via this hyperspace pod to Drengir homeworld. And they followed him back in a pod because Reath ended up there as well. And then they got shut down by the stasis field. There's more to the story than that. But again, the Drengir, at least in this book, are put in stasis. I don't think it took all over the galaxy because, as we know in the comics, right, they're showing up again. Then we've got these other stories that kind of involve the Bind Guild. And we touched on that a little bit when we were talking about Afi Hollow. And I want to talk a little bit about the character of Leox Jassy, which is, again, the captain of the vessel. And he's an interesting character. You know, Claudia Gray had said back on the High Republic show that she thought of him, and it's what would happen if Matthew McConaughey had a starship. And when I was reading it, I was reading all of his dialogue in Matthew McConaughey's voice, and I kept doing, you know, all right. And, you know, welcome, glorious children, and that type of thing in there. But the narrator had a little bit of a different take if you're listening to the audiobook, which, as much as I enjoyed the audiobook, I wasn't as big a fan of his voice for Leox Jassy because it wasn't enough Matthew McConaughey. And if Claudia Gray had never said that, I'm sure I would have been fine with it. But, you know, once you put that in my brain, there we go. So
try listening to it in like 1.6 speed, and then then it's really crazy trying to put him as Matthew McConaughey.
Right. So how would you describe him, Jay? Because he's pretty laid back. He's not really self-absorbed. The vessel is transporting spice when it picks up the Jedi, and so they hide that at all time. And he knows a lot of the secrets of the Bind Guild, but he's not sharing them with Afi Hollow, so he's kind of trying to protect her from those things. And those secrets of the Bind Guild are that they encourage a certain amount of illegal activity, that they indenture some of their pilots. And these are all practices that are frowned upon by the Republic, and Scover has not let Afi in on it. But I'm trying to figure out what the question is I'm trying to ask you here. I liked Leox. He had a lot of great redeeming qualities, And in a way, I suppose he's kind of like the epitome of what the Buying Guild should have been.
Mm-hmm.
But what did you think about him?
He's a very multi-layered character, to say the least. And at his core, he's not all that different from the Jedi, really. And what I think is ironic is that, you know, he oftentimes calls Jedi these monks because they have these very specific ideals and very specific rules that they follow for their own lives. And they give up certain things in relationship to other things. But yet he's the same way in a lot of ways.
Right.
And he's a tough one to really put your finger on in terms of being able to say that he's this or that, which I think honestly is brilliant on the part of Claudia Gray, that she was able to come up with a character that we're not able to say, oh yeah, this sort of, you know, thing kind of fits them versus this one and this trope or whatever. So I appreciated him from that regard. And I do feel that he, as you said, he was really kind of everything that the Buying Guild should have been. And he was actually a lot more righteous than I gave him credit for. And because they talked about him as being the spice user and that type of thing. And he's very adamant about saying medicinally. And ironically, it's the medicinal spice that actually helps Des recover in the end. So yeah, he's again very multi-layered, but again, I take my hat off to Claudia Gray. I think he's a brilliant character. I really do.
Yeah, he's very zen. When
zen is a good word.
When they get to that Amaxing station and all the ships start docking with it to protect themselves from the flares, we get the Mizzi and the Orinicans, which are and another criminal group that gets on there, and they start causing trouble, and no one wants to share their resources because they're going to be on the station for a while. They have to wait out this solar activity before they can go anywhere. And then he just kind of comes down the boarding ramp from the vessel and is like, you know, this is a pretty nice place. We could be in worse places. And, you know, it's good to be alive. We could be trapped out someplace and at least we know where we are. And there's others that have died in this hyperspace disaster. And he's just kind of like seeing the bright side of life with everything. And then eventually it brings everybody around that's there.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the same time, he's very good at realizing what is and is not good for Affy to know at this point. And she stumbles upon all these activities that the Buying Guild is up to because she discovers that the Amaxing Station has become kind of a way station for them. And her parents actually ended up dying because they tried this trick where they attempted to boost their power of their ship with the energy rings of the Amaxing Station, which would have cut down like their fuel usage to like a tenth, which would have made their voyage much more profitable and help them pay down their indentured servitude. But if you don't do it right, it causes your ship to blow up. And that's what happened to them. And so, I mean, I can't approve of everything he did because he did kind of withhold some stuff from Affy when she was figuring it out. But then he always came around in the end. And at the very end of the novel, once Affy has confronted Scover with what she knows about the Buying Guild and Scover's not doing anything, Affy turns it over to the Republic, and so Scover and a bunch of people get a bunch of others in the Buying Guild get arrested, and when they basically come, that'd be the High Republic, to tell Leox, you're the captain of the ship, so it belongs to you. And he's like, no, the highest ranking person on the ship inherits the ship, and that's the heir, you know, Affy, to the Buying Guild. So this is her ship. And he didn't have to do that. And Affy wouldn't have known any better at the time. So I like the character. It was interesting. Like I said, a couple times in the audio version, I didn't agree with the way that he was being voiced, but I couldn't have done that for an entire novel. And so, yeah. All right. Well, we're running out of time here. Is there anything else about this novel that we need to discuss before we wrap this up?
Well, there's a few things that strike me. You know, we were talking about Affy and the way that she ended up going forward with all the evidence against Scover. I was actually in some ways kind of surprised that she went through with it. Were you?
I was a little bit because it seemed like she had made her mind up not to. And then the next thing we know, Scover is getting arrested.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And Scover really did seem genuinely to care for her. And I don't know if it was a product of at first maybe some guilt that she had lost her parents, and maybe Affy was the only orphan in the Vine Guild. I don't know, but I kind of feel that that might be even a little bit of a stretch. So I wonder, you know, what was it about Affy or Scover herself that made her want to take her under her wing and adopt her the way that she did? But I really liked Scover as a character too. As far as how she was very kind of matter of fact, but yet she was also all about the business and that type of thing. But I really appreciated their relationship with each other. And I was kind of sad to see that end. And another thing that struck me was that the Amaxine warriors, the way that they were characterized in this novel, really weren't all that different from the Nihil, quite honestly. Mm-hmm. And the way that they were using some of these hyperspace routes or their own routes, as the Nihil call them, their paths, and, you know, that type of thing. There was some similarity to that struck me. I did really enjoy this novel. And now that we're talking about it, there's so much to this. We didn't really even talk about Nan and Haig very much. And, you know, the way that they figured out that they were Nihil and kind of their part in all of this. I do want to know a little bit more about these four artifacts or idols, the insect, the human, the amphibian, and the bird, which was the north, south, west, and east in the station, and what their true backstory is or their true meaning, why those were chosen, and, you know, who exactly did put them there. You know, we know that it was the Sith, but who and when? And so, you know, my brain is kind of going all over the place because I think there's probably a lot of breadcrumbs that were actually dropped in this book that we're going to see kind of all over the place. You know what I mean? And it's going to be a lot more far reaching, I think, than we realize just at face value in this book. And, you know, I think that this is a book that I'm going to have to revisit again, because I know that there were things, even as I was, and I was telling you that I was listening to it and then I would read and then I would listen to it and read, and I would catch little things here and there over and over again. I am completely enamored with Orla. I think she is really, really cool. And I'm so sad to have seen her go. I want to know more about her as a Jedi. And I also really, really like all of the new characters that are being brought into this. I love Geode. I know I laugh every time I think about him and every time I talk about him, but I kind of appreciate it. And, you know, and with the double-bladed lightsaber and the white that we talked about with Orla as well, I just think that there's more to that story, as we said, with the Kyber crystal. And I think that we're going to find out. So yeah, there's a lot to this, and I'm going to stop now because I could keep talking all night. So what about you?
Well, yeah, I think we're going to see Nan again, because this book ends. Last scene is her departing to Marcion Row, which we know is the big bad of the Nile. And so there's that. I mean, I hate to shortchange the Nile, but while they were in this, the bigger part of the book really was the Amaxing Temple, what was going on with the Dringir and those Sith artifacts that they found, and then the relationship amongst the Jedi themselves. And like you touched on what was going on with Arlo Jenny and Komak finding, you know, his some sort of peace, a major peace with the Jedi Order. You know, Des Ryden, like we said, took the Barash vow. I'm not entirely sure why he did that. I don't think that he did anything that necessitated that. So again, it's just kind of this, that just didn't ring true for me, that he needed to do that or he should have done that. Again, this like this, these fault lines in the Jedi Order, it's just not the way that this era was set up or built when they were talking about it. So we'll see how things go forward from here. But I know we're going to see Reath Silas pretty quickly again in some upcoming books, and he's going to work with Renestra Rowe and some of the other characters we've met elsewhere. But again, I liked it overall. I think if I'm rating the three books right now, Light of the Jedi is my favorite. This is number two. And then A Test of Courage is number three. And frankly, if we're going to include the comics, then I put those ahead, A Test of Courage as well. But I liked everything so far. It's been a great era to explore in Star Wars.
I agree. I still haven't gotten into A Test of Courage yet. It's still sitting on my table. So I need to grab that one and pick that one. Now that I'm done with this one, I feel like I can. I do still have the third issue of the comic to read as well, but I'm definitely enjoying everything so far.
All right. Well, that brings us to the end of this episode. I'd like to thank you all for listening to this discussion of Into the Dark. We'd like to remind you that we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust over on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, wherever it is you listen to your podcast, including the RetroZap Podcast feed. Just a couple other things. If you're feeling generous, we'd greatly appreciate it if you could take just a few seconds to head over to Apple Podcasts and leave us a 5-star rating and review. That always helps out with our algorithm over there on Apple Podcasts and helping others find the show. And don't forget to look us up on social media, say hello, share your favorite episode and the like. Jay can remind everybody where they can do that.
Always my pleasure. We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And I just want to take a second to welcome all of our new followers that we have. We have a lot of really great discussions on all of our social media. And that also includes our Discord channel. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in just a second. So we are Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. Dennis is at DJKVER2 on Twitter, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out all of our Pinterest boards and our YouTube channel that has all of our show episodes as well as our unboxing videos of some really great products. And like I said, our Discord room over on the Discord RetroZap server is amazing. We're having so many great chats with all of our friends over there. And there's not just our room, but there's a lot of other dedicated rooms on the RetroZap server as well. So if you want to join us, just go to our show page and click on the community tab, and it'll take you right to where you need to go. And last but not least, we'd love it if you would support us by going out to teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. So on our TeePublic site, you can pick up all kinds of Podcast Stardust swag, from t-shirts and sweatshirts, coffee mugs, phone cases, stickers, you name it, and it's over there. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all of those great show logo designs.
I think we could have them build us some Sith idols over there on
TeePublic. Ooh, good idea.
All right. Okay, then. That'll do it for episode 237 of Podcast Stardust. For Jay, I'm Dennis. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.